G'day folks, Rod Moore from Moore Art School. Welcome to this live stream. I'm coming to you from my studio in Noosa, beautiful part of Queensland, Australia. Actually, this is my temporary studio. I'm moving next week, so this is probably one of the last times you'll see me in this studio. A little bit of background noise today, so I apologise for that. We're going to do a great little river scene today, actually, of Noosa River with some sunlight as the sun sets and a bit of reflection in the water. One of the most popular classes I used to teach to all my friends who used to come to my art classes down in Melbourne was this similar sort of scene to what we're going to do today. So this is going to be a fun little exercise. I'll just move this one out of the way, one that we've been working on, and grab a canvas. Okay, so this is a 16 by 20 canvas, I believe it is. Find somewhere to hook that on. So I think it's a 16 by 20 canvas. And what we're going to do, if you're new to my videos, let me just give you a brief rundown. I teach what I call the Moore method of painting, which is a simplified approach to painting that anybody can use, even if you're an absolute beginner. I've taught hundreds of students in workshops and classes, and thousands online using my Moore method of painting. And it just simplifies everything right down so that you can get started painting. That's what I love doing, is helping beginners get started. So to simplify things down, we're going to use a simple palette, right? We're going to use three simple colours: ultramarine blue, alizarin crimson, yellow ochre, and titanium white. And then we'll introduce a little bit of cadmium yellow just to punch up some of our highlights on our trees a bit later on. 90% of our painting is going to be done with those three colours: a blue, a red, and a yellow. They're good earthy colours that help you create a natural looking landscape or a seascape scene. So we're going to use three colours, and we're also going to use three brushes. Okay, got one soaking here, I'll just give that a bit of a draft. Most of our painting is done with a little gesso brush. It's a little 1-inch gesso brush, and it's got natural sort of hog hair. That's what we're going to do most of our painting with, a little flat brush, just a little one, and we're going to use for our details a little liner brush. Okay, so we've got three brushes, three colours, three brushes, and three basic steps that we're going to use through this painting. Okay, so let's get into it. And I was going to start off with my 1-inch brush, just going to swish it around in some thinner. Now, I got asked the other day, what sort of mediums and things do I use? I don't, I just use gum turpentine, and I use that to thin the paint down, as you can see there. Okay, just get a little bit of the ultramarine blue, a little bit of the alizarin crimson, that makes a nice sort of purpley mauve colour. Okay, and we want this to be a fairly liquid mix, because what we're going to do right now is step one of the Moore method, which is to draw in your big shapes. And it's all about just placing things in the right location on our canvas. Okay, so get it nice and runny, don't worry about if it runs down there. And we're going to put in our horizon line, which is going to be around about just below the 1/3 mark. Actually, I'm going to bring it up a little bit, bring it up just to about there. The reason why I'm bringing it up is I want to have nice reflections in the water, and need to allow some space for those reflections, right? So when I teach the Moore method of painting, three simple steps. Step one, place a few marks on the canvas to show us where the big shapes are going to go. So what we're going to do is we're going to do a little river reflection. We've got this distant bank here, okay, on the far side, and it's got a tree line. It's all sort of mangrovey and so on. And so what that means, we're going to do some reflections, then we need to just replicate those roughly. Now, you don't have to get your reflections perfect. This is the secret about reflections. It doesn't have to be absolutely perfect with what's above, because the mind doesn't sort of sit there and analyze and compare. When the mind just takes a snapshot of this, as long as it closely approximates, it's going to look right. And trust me, this is going to look great when we get this one finished. Okay, so in this scene here, we're going to introduce a little bit more. I want the water to come through here, and I want to, perhaps I'm going to push forward here. Okay, so we're going to just come in with a bit of a closer bit of land there, and reflection. So there's the embankment there. So we've got a distant embankment, and we've got an embankment here. Okay, and the water meanders its way out through the back there. Okay. Don't fuss too much about this, just as long as you get some basic shapes in here, that'll be fine. So I've got reflection, We've got reflection there, okay? And then in the distance, and the reason why I want to do that is in the distance we've got a little bit of a mountain range. I don't even know what that mountain's called, but there's a little mountain that you can see at certain parts of Noosa River right there. Might be up towards Pomona, up that way somewhere. Maybe somebody watching can explain to me what that mountain is. But if we just work on just getting that in there, something like that, maybe it needs to come over a bit, over to about there. Okay, so that's going to make a nice little interesting composition here. I'm going to have a lot of sun glow through here. I'm going to reflect that in the water in here. And then what I want to do, to give it a bit more perspective, is I'm going to bring in an embankment here. We'll make it a little bit sandy there. Okay, we'll make it an embankment there. And we are going to put in a couple of, or maybe just one, a big old tree right there. Okay, so that's pretty much all I do as far as drawing. You don't need to be a great drawer of this. You can see I've just squiggled on a few marks just so I know where things are going to go. It's more about understanding composition than it is anything else, right? Understanding that that horizon line there, you don't want that in the middle of the painting because it's not going to look quite right. So it's really about understanding composition. Now we've got a lot of sky in here, so we're probably going to need a couple of little clouds sort of wifting through here to make the sky interesting, okay? But I'm going to start off, I'm going to we'll just block the sky initially and then put some clouds in as we go. Okay, first thing we've got to do though is have a quick sip of the coffee. Very important part of any artist's preparations, I believe. And stand back and have a look. Looks like my horizon line's running downhill a little bit to the right. And that's okay. That's why it's important to stand back and have a look. Otherwise I might not have noticed. Okay, let us begin. So I want to get a bit of that sort of sunset behind that mountain, get a nice orange or yellowy glow, something about orange. I'm just cleaning my brush here, get a little bit of thinner in it. Okay, so we're going to take some ultramarine blue. So we're now moving to step two, right? We've got our big shapes in step one. We're now moving to step two of the more method of painting, which is to block in, get some color on the canvas and block in those big shapes with the correct colors, okay? And then step three, of course, being that we then highlight, detail, and refine those shapes. Okay. So when you're blocking in, you know, doing step two in the Moore method of painting, it's important to know what tones to use, values and so on, what colours to use. So that's what we teach in the Moore method of painting, is really, you know, understanding how do we create depth and dimension in a painting. So just while I'm getting my tone mixed up here, I'm just mixing ultramarine blue, titanium white, there's a little bit of that red from before. Just want to get that tone right. While I'm doing that, I want to tell you about our free painting course. So we've got a 5-day free painting course where I go over the Moore method in a bit more detail for you, and I'll put the links underneath this video if you're watching the replay. If you're here live right now and you want to go and register yourself for that free painting course, then go to freepaintingvideos.com and you'll be able to pop your email in and I'll email you the course. And also, if you're watching the replay, on the top right-hand corner here, if you hover over there with your mouse, there'll be a little eye. And that eye is for information, and there'll be some information cards there where you can access the free painting course as well. Okay, so let's get that locked in. And if you are watching this live, I haven't publicized this at all. I just decided to do a painting. I thought I'll pop on the live stream. So if you do happen to find us here live, welcome, welcome, welcome. Let us know where you're from, what part of the world you are, how you found us, And you know, where you're up to with painting, you're just a beginner, or have you been painting a while? One of my passions in life is helping beginners to get started painting. It's part of the reason why we're now training other people to become art teachers in the Moore method of painting. Okay. That's a fairly bright version of that sky colour. Except a little bit greyer up, well, hopefully you can see the lighting's not good in the studio, but it's a bit greyer up the top there. And that's a bit happy, a bit too happy for my liking. That tone, get a bit more of my thinner in there. My thinner, if you watch my previous live streams, you'll know that I talk about my thinner being a bit dirty. And I'm going to clean out my thinner brush, bucket enough. I'm moving though, next week. Setting up a brand new studio, so they're going to have better lighting. And who knows, I might clean out my thinner bucket then, you never know. It's okay, so we're way too dark as we come down. What we're going to do is get a gradient from dark to light as we get towards the horizon here. So I put more white in there. The paint's fairly thick. I'm not moving very easily, so I'll get a bit more thinner. Now if you're doing acrylics, you don't need to worry about this part. Acrylics tends to flow a lot better, and won't have any problem putting it on. So you can do this part fairly quickly, as long as you get that gradient that we talk about. So because I'm lighter there than I am here at the moment, I'll have to come back and lighten up there. Don't worry about our tree. I know where I'm going to place the tree, so I can just paint over the tree. Plenty of white in there now. So I want to get it quite light as we get in here, so that I can easily mix in some yellow for the sun sunset. I can be a bit darker over this side if I want to be. I don't know what's going on outside, but there's chainsaws and trucks, and normally where I've been living here in Sunshine Beach, it's a sleepy little hollow, and every time I go to do a live stream here, it gets all of a sudden quite busy. Anyway, not to worry, as I said, we're moving out of here in a week. We bought ourselves a new place, which is going to have a much better studio. So we're doing these live streams a bit more regularly. Trialing out some new canvases, and they're not really, I'm not that happy with it so far. I can tell you it's a little bit not really taking the paint very well. Okay. That's not going too bad. The challenge of oils, of course, is I wanted to put my tree and foliage and so on back in there. We end up doing that on wet paint, so you have to do that part carefully. And the other thing you've got to be careful of with this painting is, as we do this sunset part, that we don't end up getting the blues and the yellow coming together. Okay, so I'm using the yellow ochre. Get plenty of white in there. Okay. And I'm not going to go up and clip into that blue until I've got this paint on here. Oops, gone over my little mountain a bit there. Could be a bit stronger, I feel. So the trick here is not to blend back and forward too much into the blue with this yellow. Because what'll happen is blue and yellow make a green, right? So as I work up here, run a few streaks. 15. That's not too bad. I could probably make the colour of pigment there a bit stronger, especially around the base here. So I'll do that. And I've lost a little bit of my treetops and my mountain there, but there's enough of it there for me to know where I want it. So I can easily go and work that back in. So that's the sun setting in the west at the end of the day. Okay. Now, let's repeat that colour, that sun setting colour there. A bit of white in there. Let's repeat that in here. We'll put a few blue ripples and so on in there. That's important that we just repeat that as a reflection in the water. So while I'm doing that, well, seeing as how I've just done that, I may as well finish off the rest of the water there. So I'll go a little bit darker than what I was in the sky. Okay. Too dark. Pick up some of that white. A little bit darker, but not too dark is the key. Lighten it off as it gets out towards, or gets further away from us, basically. And there. Okay. Blend a couple of those bits back and forward. Now we've got our sky in, we've got our water in, we can come back and do some more work, but at the moment we're just blocking in the colours. Let's work on this distant mountain here and here. So that's going to be made up of a blue, but because it is getting late in the day, sun's setting, we'll put a bit of alizarin crimson in there as well, and then we'll mix that up with some white. And that's a little bit too purpley, so a bit more blue. More blue again. That's our distant mountains there. Edge of that to be too sharp. And I'm just pulling some of that yellow down into this side of it, because presumably it would be getting some of the sunlight reflecting on there. And then we just go and repeat that in our reflections here. Okay, now, our next step, we've basically got this distant row of trees on the river. We've got this one that comes a bit further forward, bigger shape there. And then we've got this area here. So we need to block all three of those in. The distant river ones are going to be a bit more on the blue side. It needs to be a little bit darker than this here. So, and as you can see, that pretty much is. So this is a row of trees that sort of sit along out on the river there. Okay, a little bit more thinner, a bit more blue in that mix. And we're just really just crafting the tops of these distant trees here on the river. Okay, so that gets the distant bank in, and now I need to do the reflection of that. Just bring it down into here. So, just going to go slightly darker, not a whole lot darker, but just ever so slightly darker in the reflection. Because we're going to create a scenario where the water is quite still, and you know, it's a beautiful morning on the river. And notice I'm just, well, that's probably a little bit too strong, a little bit more white into that mix and a little bit more blue. More like that would mix there, I think. Yeah. Still, that's probably too blue now. Need to match it a little bit to this one here. And just pull it down. Now it's quite light through here, so I've got to be careful not to just clip that. It's going to thin out my darks, which I don't really want. But yeah, I'm not happy with this canvas at all. I'm going to buy this friend again. Taking the paint at all for some reason. Where's that white? So I'm scrubbing this on here at the moment, which is fine. Remember what I said about clipping that lighter tone there? That won't work out well. So, that's looking okay. Now, as we come forward, this riverbank here, this little island, is closer to us. So therefore, we have to get darker than that tone for here and here, and then that's going to be our darkest tone. Okay, so what we'll do is put a bit more red into that mix now. Now remember, this is all part of step two, you know, blocking in. But it's always good to remember that red tones, warm, you know, warm colours come forward. They bring the eye forward. Lighter blue, cooler colours go into the distance, okay? So that's how we create aerial perspective in a painting. Just understanding when and how to use warm and cool colours. Might be a bad idea just to pop that up in the sky like so. And then we'll just repeat that down there. Now what I'm going to do, I'm just going to clean my brush out a little bit, and in these reflections I'm just going to pull down and then a couple of horizontal strokes crossing. Okay, same here, pull the water down. Horizontal strokes. Now we'll do the same when we add in the highlights. That's coming along quite nicely. I'm happy with that. We now need to go to a darkest dark here. So our darkest dark is going to be clearly closer to black. And certainly going to be warmer if we can make it warmer. So a bit more red and a bit more of the yellow ochre in there. And you can see that looks almost black. It's not really, but it looks almost black. Probably does on the video or the live stream, because the lighting in here is terrible, which, don't worry, stick with us, because I'll be fixing the lighting when we move to our new studio next week. We'll be making sure we got better lighting, and we'll be doing these live streams, if you like them, you know. If you guys are getting value out of them, we'll do them on a regular basis. Okay. Pardon me. Now, we're not going to pull that down because that is the land that we're standing on here. Okay, this is the embankment on this side of the river that we're standing on. So it's starting to come together, okay. It's a few little elements of it that, it's a fair bit in it, but anyway, that's okay. You can start to put a few little grasses and things happening up there if you want, but that's just fiddling, I'm getting ahead of myself. Okay, now, big decision is where we're going to put the tree that we talked about. Okay, I think we need to have it maybe coming around about there. Like so. And the reason why we're doing this is going to give us some perspective and some depth in the painting when we put some foliage on it and so on. Okay. Oop, got a bit red there, which is perfectly fine. Might be worth us having another trunk that runs that way. Like so. And I'm just contemplating whether to put another little tree in there, or just the one. So if we put another one up, put a smaller one up through there, maybe. Run that one behind there. Yeah, that could work. We can strengthen that trunk up in a moment. What's important here at this stage is that we, that sky is almost dry now. shape in some gum tree. Getting some gum tree sort of shapes. Go a bit darker, a bit bluer there. Let's get the foliage in. So I won't do too much foliage on this one, so we can let the sky and everything come through. I'm just going to go to my thinner brush here. My little one inch, oh, it's not even a 1 inch, but it's a tiny little flat brush. Just to work on this trunk a bit. Now, word of advice, this canvas is not got a lot of, it didn't absorb a lot of paint onto the sky there, so I knew I could get away with that. Not always the easiest thing to do when I'm wet though. If you're doing acrylics, no problem. In fact, I might do a version of this in acrylics one time if there's enough interest. If you're doing oil paint, I could have just gone away and had a cup of tea for half an hour, just long enough to let the thinner dry out, and that would have made life a lot easier to get the the foliage and the tree trunks and everything into play there. Okay, just clean my hands. So if you're enjoying watching this video, painting this little river reflection scene here, then you might enjoy our free painting course, which you'll find at freepaintingvideos.com. On the top right hand side of the screen, if you're watching the playback, you hover over there, you'll see a little eye information come up, and you click on that. There's some access points there where you can sign up for our live stream notification list, and also get our free 5-day learn to paint video course. Teaches you all the basics and how to get started. And we'll be updating that soon with a more comprehensive look at the Moore method of painting, which is what I've been teaching my students and what we're basically doing here now. So basically what we've done is we've done step one, we drew in our big shapes. Now, we've just finished step two where we've just blocked in color, right? I haven't really done any details. We're now about to do step three. Step three is our highlighting, our finishing touches, and our detail work. And that's what really starts to bring a painting together and make it really come alive, right? So that's what we're going to do now. We'll start working on these on the distant embankment there with some highlights, and we'll put the embankment in a few little water effects and so on, and it'll start to all make sense as we pull it together. Okay, so I'll clean my brush for this. I'll get some more white and yellow ochre. Often in oil paints at this point I would go and take a bit of a break, just to let the paint settle, let the thinner dry off a bit. It really does make a big difference. So, if you were going to do this painting, though, I'd recommend you do that. Don't have to. If you've got a bit of experience with painting wet on wet, we're not using the Bob Ross, Bill Alexander techniques here. We're not using magic white and so on. Because I found two things. I found you didn't really need them, right? And that's where I started out, was learning Bob Ross, Bill Alexander on YouTube. What got me interested in painting. And I used to try that method, and I started teaching that method. Found that you didn't need magic white, magic clear, right? And that was important because in Australia here it was hard to get. So I started learning, well, how can I do it without that, right? Discovered you don't really need it. I'm not saying anything negative about Bob and Bill. I think they have done wonderful things for painting, right? What they really taught me was that it is possible with a process to teach beginners how to paint who have never painted before. And that's what the whole Moore method of painting is based on, right? So I think they've done a wonderful thing for that reason. But you don't need magic white and magic clear when you understand how oil paints work and so on. And if you're doing acrylics, of course, you don't need them at all. You could get exactly the same effect in acrylics as what we're getting here. Okay, that's enough of that. We're going to highlight these distant trees. So what we need to do, first of all, is get back to a colour that closely approximates that distant colour. So all it is blue, red and white. Okay, ultramarine blue, crimson and white. So this is how you do your highlights and how you get your tone just right on your highlights. Okay, when you get back to that colour, it's a bit dark, or actually, it's not too bad compared to this part here. So I'll strengthen that. So when you get your colour back, like you remix that colour. Okay, what you want to do then is you want to lighten it with white and you want to warm it with yellow and red. Okay, so we lighten and warm. That's probably too much of that one in there. Oh, at low, maybe. Okay, we'll just add a little bit more red in there. Is that light enough? Okay. And then just using the edge of this brush, I'm just going to tap it on where the light's coming in. I'm just tapping it there, you know, and I'm trying to create interesting looking foliage shapes. Remember, there's a distant trees, and where the sun's catching the edge of them and the tops of them, that we're getting that little bit of light effect there. We don't want it too bright though. We don't want drawing the eye too much to that section. Okay, but you know that's starting to come along okay there now. So we're getting a bit of a three-dimensional look and feel. Very good, I'm happy with that. I think that's working a treat. Okay, now, we want to keep the same tone, okay, and we want to now do the reverse. Don't have too much paint on the brush. Thing you can do is, well, actually I won't do it because it wouldn't stick on my board, but you could turn it upside down, because it's kind of what I'm doing now is doing it in the reverse. Can be a bit tricky for your head to think that through sometimes. So if you have problems with it, just turn your canvas upside down and do it in exactly the same way. Don't try and match up too much. I found when I used to try and match it all up that it was too difficult. Okay. Okay, so we've got our reflections there. Very good. Now on this one here, we're gonna go for a brighter green. So we're gonna add in that yellow and red. Whoop. Look at that red overpowering it. Wow. Let's get more yellow because this is going to be closer to the sunset here. Okay, that looks pretty powerful. It needs to be darker than the sky so that we can see it. Okay. Can you see how it's darker and it's warmer than the distant one there? Very important. It brings it forward. Okay. And the fact that the horizon line is different as well is also an important part. I'm happy with that. Put in some little embankments there, and I think that'll be fine. Probably the reflection of the hill maybe needs a bit of work there. Okay, now the embankment. We don't want one solid line all the way across, right? Try and avoid creating one big predictable shape. Do want is to break it up a little bit, make a bit of a browny tone, lighten it off with some white, and let's just test. Okay, a little thin line. I think that's going okay. See, I've left a few bits broken. I've broken up that line a bit. Just keeps it interesting, I think. It makes it a bit more real. And we'll just warm up that colour now. Darken it, so a bit of blue and a bit of red. Too much red, so I'll just add some yellow. Okay, we'll add some blue. That's not a very happy colour, that one, but let's try it. Against this stronger purple, it may work. That's not too bad, I'll just. Okay, now while I'm doing all this, hopefully the sky up here is drying off and it's going to give us a fighting chance to be able to work on the foliage and the tree there. And if you're enjoying watching the painting, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel and leave a comment, ask questions. I'm more than happy to help people out, answer their questions and so on. If you've got suggestions of what you'd like to see us paint in the future, let us know and we'll give you a shout out if we end up doing a painting that you've asked for or suggested. What sort of subjects do you want to see us do in the future? Very distant shoreline at the back there. Okay. Now then, I'm going to get back into this tree trunk here. I'm just, mixing up versions of the colour. A dark basically is what I'm aiming at. So I think overall I'm happy with the shape of the trunks. I'll add in some more branches. I just need to get a bit more of that foliage happening. So let's clean off the brush. Clean off the brush, go for a dark. We'll just strengthen up the dark tones in here. blue into there. Australian gum trees seem to hang down a little bit. That's looking a bit better. That dark, you know, the dark umbrella shape that we're creating there, very effective, I think, in making this glowing, getting that sun to glow a bit more. Just put one Lone Ranger out there. So this tree is really growing out towards the light. And back with our, got a slightly thicker script liner than my regular one. Okay, we'll just mix up some dark there. Need to get some thinner on that rod. Okay. No, this brush is pretty much had it, I think. It's all clogged together. Get rid of that one. Back to my original. To be working a bit better. Oh, pardon me, I'm terribly sorry about my coughing. Okay, let's now bring some more branches in like so. Just add in twigs sticking out that way. So look at that! Look what that does to the reflection of the in the water there. It just sets it all right back into the water. That's what I love about painting. You know, when you can create that sort of effect of a 3D world with 2D on a 2D canvas, you know, it always gives me a buzz. So that's just a bit of a stray twig that we've got sticking out there, but you know, in terms of making the composition work, quite an important little piece. Now, I'm not going to go overboard with these, hopefully, he says, wondering whether he already has. what I'm going to do is put the bit of foliage on there first, and then we'll pick up some highlight on the trunk, and we'll just see where we're at before I go and put too many twigs and things in there. So, foliage here. We really want that to be our brightest sort of tone, bright green. So that's where I add in this punch colour, this cadmium yellow, right? Just to pick it up a little bit. Remember the rest of the painting, 90% of the painting has been in our three earth colours, our three base colours. Ultramarine blue, alizarin crimson and yellow ochre, right? But as we come down to getting some of these highlights, at that point we go, well, you know what? We just want to punch the colour up a little bit here now. And that's when I then start to introduce that cadmium yellow into the equation. Now, don't is all the darks. Try and keep as many of those as we can. Yeah, like so. Stop there, and I think we need a little bit more of that yellow. Some titanium white and some yellow ochre. Right there. Start to highlight up those trunks. Let's see what happens. There slowly. This is the step three where we're doing the detailing, highlighting, and so on. Is the part where we slow down, we take our time, and really work on finessing the paint and giving it just what it needs to make it come alive, right? That's what we want to do. What's going to make this painting really come alive and sing is the question we ask ourselves. Certainly getting there. Need a bit of foreground grasses and so on here. So we'll get to those next. My hand is getting paint everywhere here at the moment. Some painters are clean painters and others are messy painters, and I'm a messy painter. Unfortunately, I think I might even have it on my face, but not to worry. Hope you're enjoying this demonstration, Noosa River sunset. I'm certainly enjoying doing it. It's been a nice little painting to have a go at, and it's definitely one you can have a go at home. Even if you're an absolute beginner, just follow the steps that I've been giving you and put it together piece by piece. And you could do this one quite easily, I suspect, at home. Might just watch the video back through a few times and take some notes. And hey, send me a photo of your efforts with this one. Because what I love is seeing our students getting results, you know, starting to do paintings that they are excited about and maybe didn't think that they could do before they had a go. A few little watermarks there. So I've taught hundreds of students through our workshops. I've had the good fortune to do so, and online as well. It's always very rewarding when people who think that they can't paint, or maybe have always wanted to have a try but never had the courage to give it a go, and then all of a sudden they come to a workshop or they watch a video like this and get excited, and all of a sudden they've done their first painting. And when they show their family and friends, they're absolutely amazed what they've been able to achieve. And you can do that too, you know, it's not that difficult to do. Just needs to simplify things. Beginners make things way too complex. They've got 25 different brushes, 25 colours, you know what I mean? Like going to the art supply store and you're overwhelmed with all this stuff, and you've, if you're anything like me, you feel like you have to have it all, you know? Truth is, that's the worst thing you can do as a beginner. You just want to get some basics. Okay. Now I'm probably overdoing because I'm talking while I'm applying these little watermarks. So what I'm going to do is take a dry brush, dry flat brush. I'm just going to soften those in. Don't want these to catch your eye too much. A few of them are okay, but not too many, not too many. Okay, now, let's go back. You can see I'm chopping and changing. As I see one thing, you know, I go and fix that. Then I see another thing, so I know I need to fix that. Let's get some yellow with a bit of yellow ochre in there, a bit of the red, just to dull it back a bit, okay. And then we've got our sun setting over here. So we just need to get a bit more sunlight just into this side here, not everywhere. Certainly in a few spots. Just tone it back a bit where we need to. So see, I've just got that left hand side which is catching the setting sun there. Don't want to put it over on the shadowy side. Too bright up in there, so we'll just pick up some of that green and we'll just soften it back in, no big deal. Okay, now just gonna soften that edge a little bit. Because it's getting later in the day, most of that tree there is in, you know, shadow. But I've got sort of a purpley tone to it because it was just a dark shadow. It could get a bit boring, and having that bit of red into it just helps to keep it interesting. But what I can do is just in a few spots just add in a few darker tones, make it a bit more of an interesting tree trunk. So get some on the cool side. Get in a couple of blues. I don't know whether that's going to show up on the camera with the lighting. We've already talked about that. A bit budding out there. Okay, so what's left? We could do some grasses around here. So we just get a bit of a green happening. And I'll just scruff up the edge of that brush and just get clumps of grasses and so on happening in there. Don't want to lose all of the darks on this embankment though, at all. So we're going to go for a dark green, especially over here. I'll clip a couple of those as highlights. Coming off the brush there, but see, I'm going to leave a little bit of that dark around there as well. But what we'll do is we'll just scrunch up the end of the brush like so, and we'll talking some highlights there. One or two here and there. Like so. And that just now creates a, you know, a bit of a bushy sort of embankment there. And I'm just going to get some dark, just hit a few spots through here that have got a bit out of control, a bit mucky. Yep. Some white, and should I be really daring here? I'm just thinking out loud at the moment, folks. Should I be really daring here and just work back into this? Just going to try and lose the top of that there. Sort of the wrong shape and it was jarring on me, and which we don't want, we never want that sort of scenario to happen. Okay. Come back up in here and we'll just what we could, I mean, you, what you could do is you could put some little tree trunks up in there. Let's do a couple, just to show you. Doesn't need it. We're going to keep it simple. However, just purely to demonstrate to you what you could do. So we'll take some white. It's got a bit of blue in there. All white. Okay. Very subtly though. And this goes in the darks. Whatever you do at this stage, do not overdo this part. It just adds a little something. Like so, and last little touch that I'm going to do is been on Noosa River at night, you'll know that around about dusk all the birds all start flying through. So just a couple little marks for those, and I think we're just about done. I did say we'd come back and reassess whether we needed more trunks. I mean, look, you could put them in if you want. Less is probably more at this stage. I do like to always get a couple that are escaping out into the sky like so. All right, well, I think we're done. Noosa River with the sunset and the reflections. Great little painting. It's a beautiful part of the world. If you ever get up this way, come and say hi. So, you know, basically just to recap what we've done, we've used the Moore method of painting, which is ideal for oils, acrylics, and especially designed for beginners, right? So even if you've never picked up a brush before, you could do this painting if you follow along with this video. We used three colours, ultramarine blue, lizard crimson, and yellow ochre with titanium white. And we added a bit of cadmium yellow just to punch up some highlights here to make it a bit brighter in a few spots. But 90% of our painting, three colours, okay? We use three brushes, the gesso brush, the flat brush, and a little script liner brush for doing our branches and things. And then we use the Moore method. Three steps. Step one, we just placed on the canvas a few big shapes. Where are we going to put these things, right? So we placed a few big shapes on the canvas. Step two, we blocked in the colour. And you saw how I did that, really simply with the big gesso brush, just sort of like getting the colour down as much as we can and understanding, you know, we, in the distance here, we've got our lightest, coolest colour. The shadow gets a bit darker and warmer. This shadow here is closer to us, darker and warmer again. And then this foreground is our darkest part of the painting, right? So that's during the blocking phase. And then we went to step three, highlighting, finishing touches and little details. That probably took more than half of the actual painting time. So keep that in mind. That's when you slow down and you really think about how we're going to make this painting come to life and become an interesting painting. It's a great little painting. It's designed for beginners. Have a go at it at home. And I think you'll find that you can do it if you follow the steps, right? Even if you've never painted before. Make sure you click on the eye up here. If you hover over, click on the eye. It'll give you some cards where you can get our free video course. It's a 5-day painting course. You can go and take that and learn some of the basics. You can also register for our live streams like we're doing right now. You can register for the notification list so you'll know when they're coming up and we'll show you, you know, where to get the videos and so on. If you like what we're doing here, then make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel and leave a comment, ask a question, tell us, you know, what paintings you want to see us do in the future. You know, we're here to help and we love to hear from you. What really fires me up is helping beginners get started painting. So leave a comment, ask me questions, and I'd love to chat with you. Happy painting and good luck, and I hope you've enjoyed today's painting. Cheers for now.